So without further ado, we're going to go ahead and get our program started. And today with us, we have two very accomplished speakers and major leaders in our industry. And at first, I would like to introduce Chris Todd to come up on our table here. And as you know, Chris Todd is our great leader, CEO of our NVAR. She chairs many positions in the real estate industry. She sits on the MRIS board. She also serves with Central Lock and Northwest Capital Management, and also sits on the board of director for Realtor.com. So Chris has been in the industry, or in this neighborhood, and in our industry for 26 years. And sadly, we have to say goodbye to her at the end of this year, but that's another program. So, but welcome, Chris. And our second guest speaker is David Charron, and he is the CEO and chair of MRIS. And David is voted in the top 10 most influential people in the real estate industry by Inman News. And also, he was voted by Swan Poll to be one of the most 100 most influential people in our industry. And he has a longer list, and if his mom was here, she'll be super proud. But because the program is short, we're only going to say those two things. So welcome, David. And so today, as you know, we had shared with you the danger report, and hopefully all you guys did get a chance to skim the report, all 160 pages of it, because at the end we're going to go ahead and take a quiz, okay? So, but in the meanwhile, Chris and David, we're going to have a discussion, and it's not a formal presentation, so write down some of the key questions that you can bring up during their discussion. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to Chris and David.
Thank you. Thank you. So you see, the different one said danger report. You know, what does that mean? And you can see how it's spelled out here. It's kind of interesting. It's a definitive analysis of negative game changes emerging in real estate. Now people will say, you know, why would the National Association of Realtors spend a lot of time and money doing an analysis of dangers that could be coming across the horizon that could impact our livelihood? And I thought about it. You know, a couple of years ago, I went and had one of those full body scan MRIs, and I had this, and someone said, why are you going and doing this full body scan? And you know, then you know, you're going to find out all these things about yourself, and you know, it could be bad. And I said, you know, it could be. But I want to know now if there's anything horrible growing inside my body or something that's going on that's really bad, because then I can take definitive action to either prepare myself mentally, or maybe I have to have an operation or change my diet or do something. So it's what you do not know that can harm you. And I think the National Association of Realtors is to be commended for, you know, putting together this particular study. They did it for three reasons. They wanted to identify challenges facing the industry, and David's going to talk a little bit later on about what all those challenges. I mean, let's face it, I've been around doing this since 1978, and I've seen a lot of challenges, and some of them, they knock us over, and some of them are just have no impact whatsoever, but we should know what these challenges are. Then NAR, the National Association of Realtors, wanted realtors nationwide to start having a dialogue about some of these concerns. Let's start talking about it. Let's not think that nothing is going to happen, everything's going to be fine. I just was at Reggie Coppola was just telling me, he said, oh, Chris, he said, I just had an office meeting, and I brought this up in my office meeting, and my agent's discussing this for 2 hours. How positive is that? That's really good that people are at least thinking about this. And then finally, the National Association of Realtors is going to challenge each local association, each MLS, their board of directors, to make improvements so that if there are some dangers on the horizon that can threaten our livelihood, our profession, we're prepared for it. So I really commend them for that. Now, some people were really angry and said, you know, why did the National Association of Realtors release this report to the media? You know, we should just have kept it secret. I mean, in this day and age of internet and everything else, that would have been ridiculous, because it looked like we're trying to hide something. It makes things look even worse. So their strategy was, let's do an internal audit, and then let's release it to all the local associations, to all of our 1 million members. And if Ken Hardy from the Washington Post wants to comment on it, let him. We will have our response when that's necessary. So that was the reason why it was done. It was written by a gentleman by the name of Stefan Swanepoel, and some of you may have read his trends reports, and he's the one that ranked. Dave, what number were you this year?
George W. Bush, 43, I think.
43, all right. So at 100, it was 43. I mean, I'm impressed. I think next year the number will go up even more. But Stefan Swanepoel is considered, you know, a great industry leader, and he analyzes trends, he watches trends, and matter of fact, he will be the opening keynote speaker at our October 13 convention. So, you know, we have that convention every year at the Northern Virginia Community College. It's free, just bring a bag of groceries. It's worth it. This guy cost a fortune, but I think it was worth it to have him come and speak to you. So please understand. So he wrote the report, and he's going to be our speaker. So if you have questions about some of the points, you can challenge him even more than us. So I wanted to remind you about that. There were many people who were interviewed for the report, and coincidentally, David and I were two of the 74 executives. So, you know, that was kind of fun, because I put that camera right in your face, didn't you?
Yeah.
Pointing questions at me. I thought I was going to fall off the chair, but a very dynamic, high-powered person. But it was a very well-done report in terms of the amount of people that were involved and the data that they used. It's not just something that was arbitrarily done by a small committee at the National Association of Realtors. They really did their homework. And they identified 5 danger areas that we should be aware of. Dangers to agents, we're going to talk about that. Dangers to brokers. Dangers that may impact the National Association of Realtors, the largest trade association in the world. Dangers impacting state and local associations like VAR and Northern Virginia Association of Realtors. And most importantly, dangers to the multiple listing service. So these were the areas that they identified, and then they went ahead and started to give their report. So I thought it would be fun to talk first about the dangers to the MLS, because let's face it, that's where you make your livelihood. If the MLS goes down, we all go down. And so I'm going to start asking David if he would comment on one of these dangers that was identified in the report. It was interesting. It said, the current warlike environment in real estate becomes attractive to a large non-industry company that sees opportunity. What are they talking about?
Thank you, Chris. My position here is not to debate, it's to discuss, it's not to defend the report. There are certain things in the report that I don't agree with. You know, I used to be a consultant, and when you did consulting gigs, you'd go out and you'd canvass the organization, and you would find out, interview a dozen, 15, or in this case, 74 people, and you get these thematic issues. And then you come back with your report, and you, man, that guy really gets it. He understands our business. But what he did, and what I did, and what we all do is, in our consulting capacity, is we tell people what they already know, we just organize it in such a way. And then we put our 20% spin on it. So we know 80% of it. So kudos to Stefan for identifying it. His 50 dangers, or 50 shades of gray, I would encourage all of us as we look through this to decide whether or not we can have one influence over it, and then create your 50 opportunities as opposed to dangers alongside it. That's the exercise I think that we should all be involved in going forward. So the current warlike environment, given the velocity of change, given the speed of innovation, it's only natural that it causes us to examine our vulnerabilities, our soft underbelly, and then see just what we can do to modify our behavior, our practice, our business to overcome whatever that challenge is. Like all industries, we are imperfect. There isn't one industry I know of that is perfect. What we are is, in the case of the MLS, we're really an organic monopoly. For the attorneys in the room, I've said it, but we really are. We are the default exchange. And so with all this noise going on in the periphery of our business, We've got to be aware of that. And does it impact our ability to move forward? And how long is our time horizon? Well, I'll tell you, my time horizon's gone from 5 years to 3 years to probably 24 months right now. So I don't worry about being replaced overnight. I don't worry about that. I mean, MRIS facilitated $45 billion in residential real estate transactions last year, so I don't know that anybody's going to put that at risk overnight. But we need to be aware of the debate that's going on and the discussions that are going on, just like this one, that I think are really helpful. They'll help me. So I don't worry about a large non-industry participant coming in and taking over our business. I really don't worry about that. Real estate is local. But I do think to one of the challenges and one of the dangers is there's going to be a national MLS. And what's that going to mean? Well, I think real estate is local. I think there could be a national database. But I don't think there's going to be a national MLS. There's no national weather forecast, right? So it's just, it's going to be awfully hard to make that happen. It doesn't mean it's impossible. But if I look at a Home Depot or a Google or maybe even a Zillow that would come in and take over our business, why would they? The real estate transaction is not, in and of itself for brokers, is not that profitable. It is not that profitable. It's all the ancillary businesses where all the profit is. But it's almost like RE/MAX getting in the TV production business or starting its own HDTV-like show or opening up a department store. I don't see us doing that, nor do I see them coming into us. But I don't think it's appropriate, in wrapping up, I don't think it's appropriate that we consider it a warlike environment other than it's a debate. And because this industry has been so insular and so impervious to change, and because so many people come in and say, this is an industry ripe for change because of all the dysfunction, I don't see that. I do see the increased level of debate, but as far as the MLS is concerned, it is an imperative that we define and defend our value proposition every day, just like every one of you in the room do. You have to define and defend it. Why am I an agent? What's the value I'm going to bring to you, the home buyer, home seller? Why should you pay me X number of dollars in order to do that? It's no different from us. So guess what? We welcome MLS to the 2015 or whatever it is. So I'm not at all troubled by this statement at all.
What about the idea, one of the dangers also identified with MLS was hackers coming in and just stealing the database or corrupting it and then taking it offline, and all of a sudden we're all out of business.
Yeah, well, we don't have a corner on people trying to hack our business, that's for sure. I think there are some less than scrupulous folks that might come in and occasionally change the data if they had the opportunity to. We did an experiment, and I apologize, it was an experiment on not a guinea pig, but on live people about 8 years ago, and how many people remember the key fobs? You know, it was a mistake. It was, if I look back on my career at MRIS, it was surely one of the biggest mistakes I ever made. It was well-intentioned, but we ended up impinging upon the value of the legitimate users of the system. And that was really wrong in order to get the 4 or 5%. So we've now evolved into keystroke rhythms such that the system identifies how quickly you log in, the device that you log in from, the time of day. If something comes out of the ordinary in any one of those, the speed with which you enter, if anything is out of the ordinary, it asks you some challenge questions. So it's really, that's it. Now on a larger scale, MRIS was involved in a fairly recent copyright infringement litigation, series of litigation, where we were, unfortunately, the plaintiff in this. We went after some bad guys that were scraping data from Realtor.com and then putting it on their own website, a company called Neighbor City. And so we sent them a cease and desist letter. When we found out about it in 2011, they flashed the Virginia number one sign at us, and so then we proceeded down the road with litigation. 3 years later, and quite a bit of money later, we have a lot of case law that has been determined in the Fourth Circuit Court that will at least distract others from doing the same thing. We didn't get a dollar for dollar on our expense. So, you know, whether it's from the data entry piece to the whole user experience to other third parties swiping the data, it's something that we're constantly watching. We're about to implement PickScout, which will take any images that you as agents submit to the system, and we will map that first against the Getty database, because how many people have gotten letters from Getty Images? There have been a lot of people in the industry that get those for stock images that you load. So agents go out. We've got agents right now. They list a house over by the Silver Line, and they take a picture off Google. They take an image off of Google, and they say, here's the metro station. That's somebody else's image. You don't have rights to that. So we have to take it down as soon as we're notified of it. Well, what ideally will happen after we map it against the Getty Images is we will be able to map it against a number of other databases where these images will reside so that we can immediately suspend it. So there's a lot of things going on in the security business. The challenge for us is, yeah, they can change the data, they can hijack the data. What we really try and do is make sure they can't get to any of your sensitive information. And that's the big thing, because I do feel that the next form of terror really hits home when it hits our pocketbooks. I'm sorry, I realize there's stuff going on around the world, and it is terribly unfortunate. And those things will continue, and hopefully they don't come to our shores, but they certainly do. Of course they do. But financial terror is one thing, so we've really got to be mindful of that. So when you are required to change your passwords, things like that, do it. Do it again and again and again. Keep your passwords in a safe place.
David, and to follow up on that as well, I think another thing that MRIS does that's very well, that protects us from the danger of, you know, if there's a catastrophe, a couple of years ago when we had an earthquake here, I mean, even the NVAR, a brand new building, we had tremendous cracks in the building, we had to go in and do quite a bit of repair, and some systems went down. So what does MRIS do to protect the database from a catastrophe, especially in an area like here? I hate to say, where there is some vulnerability in our neighborhood.
Well, yes, that's a great question, and we have been working on this for a number of years. We've got a secondary site. Our primary site now is in Gaithersburg, soon to move to Ashburn in the next month. Our secondary site was in upstate New York, and now it's in Seattle. So those systems are both what is called active systems. They are both live, they are both hot, they both have the most current information, and both of them say to each other, do you get it? Did you get it? I didn't get it. Send it again. Did you get it? And so when one goes down, within about 5 or 7 minutes, we make the determination as to whether or not we need to roll over, fail over, to the hot backup site, or we can fix it at the primary site. It generally, you know, the system will hiccup. It's unfortunate. At times, we'll affect a couple of hundred users. Our job is to make you think we never make mistakes. We do make mistakes. Technology isn't flawless. And so you think, what happened there? I just got bumped. Well, it could have been there was, in the case of the earthquake, we went down. We went down hard, but we rolled back over to the other system upstate New York. A bigger issue was Sandy, when Sandy came through, because Sandy almost took out our New York facility as well. So that's why we decided we needed to go completely off the grid and go out to the West Coast.
Well, that's great, because that is something that's, you know, I learned many, many years ago. We did a detour conversion of MLS, you know, and when that system went down, believe me, I heard about it. And people lost a lot of money, and it was not pretty. The other thing I was reading about here, about, again, just to get on the MLS one more time, is to talk a little bit about this, something called this Project Upstream. You know, right now, what the beauty of MLS is, it's brokers getting their listings and sharing it with their competition and sharing their commission, and everybody works as competitors, but they work in a cooperative environment. And that's the whole genius and beauty of the MLS. You think about, what other business do you have people sharing their information and their commission and working so well together? That's the genius, I think, of the multiple listing service. But now there's something I'm reading here about this Project Upstream, where people actually want to put their listings upstream of the MLS. Can you explain what that is and what's the impetus behind it?
The idea is to take greater control over the information on behalf of the brokers, and the brokers have, you know, they're working to reclaim high ground, and understandably so. In the last several years, as the economy has improved, brokers essentially ceded responsibility for that information to the local MLSs back when they were running their businesses back in the early 2000s, maybe even the 99s. Then we went through the euphoria of a big market upturn. Then, of course, we went through the doldrums and the hangover associated with the 2007 to 2012 or thereabouts time frame. And so over the last several years, there's been a lot of discussions about there's too many MLSs, there's too many rules, there's too many regulations at the local level that the brokers have to deal with, and particularly for those brokers that span multiple markets, it's very difficult. So one of our brokers in our market belongs to 27 MLSs. Well, you know, if we change one thing within one of those MLSs, they have to change it on their end too, because they're pulling all that information in. So there's a thought that if they were able to have a common data entry platform, think Keystone, just on a local level, but think of it on a national level like Keystone, have it input into a aggregated database, think Cornerstone, because that's where your listings go to, and then they come out in Matrix. They don't go into Matrix. They actually go through Keystone to our own back-end database, and then out back out to you, and then have the brokers have a dashboard where they can determine on a very as frequent as they want basis where their listings are going to go. So they put it into upstream, and they decide, I want it to go to the Washington Post, I want it to go to Zillow, I'd like for it to go to MRIS, and I want it to go to Richmond. And so that's the idea behind it, is to just gain greater control and influence over the information. It's not just a large broker initiative, it's not just a franchise initiative. Think of it as a silo of corn, and all the listings go into that, and then it's controlled as to where it goes and who uses it, and also how it's monetized. Taking that away from the local level as to how that data may be monetized. So the second thing I think that brings value to upstream was really born out of our challenge, which is the copyright challenge. If they have a single way to register the copyrights to that asset, then it's going to be so much better. The brokers were lucky, I think, that MRIS is the one that took the lead in the copyright challenge, because our copyright process was upheld repeatedly. It was upheld. So I think that, but that isn't the way it is in other markets around the country. So you've got franchises that want it, you've got big brokers that want it, you've got small brokers that want it. You've got legal implications for this. There's lots of ways in which I think it's, in the monetization, of course, of all of this, and who gets it and what they can do with it, I think it's better if it's in one place. Now, what does that mean for MRIS? That obviously means it could be something we have to watch, and but do we need to worry about? My customer's the broker. My owners are the associations. My other stakeholders are certainly the agents, many of you in this room. You know, we've all got to figure out a way to work this together, but I personally am a supporter of upstream notionally, and I think technically it's going to be very difficult to implement, but it doesn't mean we shouldn't try.
Yeah, and I think the great thing about upstream is that it's some people had said, oh, it's a way for the big brokers to separate themselves from the small one, and I said no, because everybody will have opportunity to place their listings upstream of the MLS and then decide where they want it to go, and that's important.
Can I ask a question? Do you think with upstream, take that broker that's got 27 MLSs, do you think there might be some market advantage that broker might want to take to say, we're in upstream and we're going to flow that listing to all 27 MLSs under the broker's authority because they're in all 27, and use that as some advantage? And then how, if they could, would that impact, how would that impact the MLSs then?
Well, they already do that now with their websites. They just assimilate all that information from the 27 MLSs, and then they put it out on their respective websites. So it really, it's a technology opportunity for brokers to get a single feed of this information, if you will, and then be able to push it wherever he or she wants to. It shouldn't really make any difference. It should just simplify the process for them, I think.
You know, we're really fortunate here in our region. We have one of the largest, most respected, and efficient multiple listing services in the United States, and I get to see that because I travel all over the country. And the genius behind it was, first of all, many years ago when we consolidated what was going on, everything from Baltimore, Washington, D.C., and then all of Northern Virginia, and put it into one big, because we're really the greater Washington, D.C. region. And you know, you had great management under the leadership of David Charron with a very, very, very talented and dedicated staff. Now, some people say, well, why hasn't the MRIS, you know, footprint grown more? Should be more people wanting to join us. Well, it's because of the decision-making on the MRIS level, as far as I'm concerned. They are not catering to the least common denominator. we don't have the cheapest MLS in the country, but we have the best. And I think the people in this region demand that. You're dealing with very high properties, expensive. You're dealing with a sophisticated market. And our members demand those type of tools to keep them competitive. So I really commend you and your staff for the great job that you do in keeping MRIS as strong as it is. Let's switch now to the dangers impacting the associations. And I wonder, and David, why don't you take this over and maybe you can ask me some questions and I'll see what I can do.
And we know she's going to have an answer, don't we? So one of the, there are a lot of, it's difficult to generalize in any of this. So just as MRIS feels like some of the dangers aren't really dangers to us or we're doing the best we can, so too does the Northern Virginia Association of Realtors and a number of our shareholders in the area. But one of the challenges is that leaders are not in lockstep with the needs of the market, let alone the demands of an eclectic constituency. So one of the issues that was raised was there's an absolute either inability or unwillingness to reach out, engage the next gen of leadership, and then make sure that they have the requisite skills to help lead the associations through whatever transition is happening going down the road. So, Christine, I know you've got a lot of experience in this area, so bring it.
Well, I think that the most important thing that associations have to do all the time is to make sure they are relevant to their members. They're providing the programs and products and services they need this day to stay in business and to be successful. So one of the biggest parts of my job is to continually look out how I can recruit new people with new skills, with new points of view, different cultures, different specialties into the association, so we always are aware of that mix of people that are going, making decisions. The other thing that NVAR started many, many years ago when I got involved with the association, they have a philosophy in NVAR is that we make big decisions around the people who are successful in the business, not the lowest common denominator. And I'll give you the perfect example. Many years ago, we were on an all-mechanical lockbox system. Hundreds and hundreds of keys were floating all around the association. It was not very secure. And I thought, if the Washington Post ever got all of this and knew that people had lockboxes that were not secure, because anybody could have a key, it'd bring the whole system down. So we went to the board of directors and said, we have to make a decision to move from these very inexpensive, flimsy, mechanical boxes, some of them combination boxes, and move to a more sophisticated electronic box. Well, the board of directors had this discussion, and finally someone said, well, you know, that's going to be really expensive, Chris. It's going to cost the average realtor, we made this conversion, $80. $80. And someone said, we're going to lose a lot of people because the market's not good right now. So maybe we shouldn't do it. And it was David Howell, I'm going to forget, he was president that year. He said, Chris, we do not make decisions around the lowest common denominator. If somebody can't afford $80 a year to upgrade a lockbox, which is protecting someone's multi-million dollar home, they do not belong in this business. So we made that decision. And I remember the week we made the conversion, we lost 1,200 members in a week. Because people came up to me crying and saying, I don't have $80. I said, well, maybe you should think about working at another place, maybe the McDonald's or something like that, because you can get a steady income there, whatever. But now other associations around the country, they say, oh no, you know, when we make a vote like that, we bring it out to the whole membership. They have to discuss it and see how expensive it's going to be. We don't, because we have to have people who are making informed decisions and decisions for the best of the profession and for the membership. I never forgot that. And to this day, we make our decisions based upon that. Remember, NVAR was the first local association in the United States to consolidate. There used to be an Arlington County Association, Fairfax, and Arlington, and Alexandria. And back in the 1960s, President, those three associations got together and said, I think if we consolidated and called ourselves Northern Virginia, because one man said, I think the growth is going to be out west or Fairfax, that's where we should be. Again, having that type of insightful leadership keeps us relevant. So I work very hard to make sure my board of directors have information like this danger report and trends report all the time, because they're making very expensive decisions that impact the way you do business. And so we're very, very proud of that. One thing that we do, and Mary Byatt will back me up on this, we were at the National Association of Realtors meeting back in May, and we will be, our association was being singled out as having such a wonderful leadership that actually reflects the profile of the members. They said, you know, you've got people on your board of directors that look like your members. They're not all looking like me. How do you do that? I said, because we made a decision years ago to have our elections, but always to have three appointed directors every year, so we can bring in people from the Vietnamese community. We can bring in appraisers, property managers, commercial, Middle Eastern, because we should have a board of directors that reflects the profile of our membership, people who are informed, people who are successful, and it's my job to make sure that they have the information they need to make great decisions. So I think that I don't see that as a danger to NVAR. Now, of course, I'm leaving.
The applause was just a little too genuine.
And someone said, you know, what are you going to say to the new CEO? And I said, I'm going to say, don't mess it up. But anyway, that's something that I think I'm really proud of. So I think when I did the assessment of the association, because you can go in and do a test for yourself, I found NVAR. I don't really find any threats to us right now. We're financially very secure, got extremely very, very talented and well-educated staff. And our board directors are fully engaged. They love doing what they do. We always have plenty of people who want to run. That's good, but you know what? That's not the norm throughout the country. But you have to work really, really hard at it. And I'm keenly aware that the people who are making decisions for you have to be informed, intelligent, and successful. And if you can keep that combination going, you're going to be fine for the next 25 years.
So I think it's actually, when you say the directors and the leadership are uninformed, some could argue that this is a horrible document to create. And I have to tell you, I have very mixed emotions, even since its original issuance. But if it does result in people sitting down and talking about, is this really us? It causes us to look in the mirror. Is this really part of our soft underbelly, or is this something we feel we are addressing or have addressed? And I think there is value in that. So Christine, you talked a little bit about the least common denominator. You talked about uninformed decisions, which I think, you know, we've covered there. You touched on consolidation. In consolidation, we have, at MRIS, have tried to consolidate. That was one of the reasons we restructured our company back in 2012, and was the idea that we would build it and they would come. And we built it and now it came. I have to tell you, for over 2 years, I've been on the road trying to talk about consolidation, and I haven't had this much rejection since high school. It's really been very, very humbling. So do we need to approach consolidation differently as opposed to acquisition or one company going away or taking over the other? Do we need to think about consolidation differently? Is it even important for the association?
Well, I don't think it's that important for NVAR because I think we already are consolidated. I do worry about the small associations that have 50 and 100 members. And as you know, the National Association of Realtors came out this year with something called the core standards, where each association has to meet 5 core standards, or they're going to get the charter revoked. Now, for NVAR, you know, it was nothing. Matter of fact, I was on the committee that put the 5 core standards in place, so, you know, we did it, you know, no problem. But I will tell you, there are hundreds of associations, including some right here in Virginia, that say, you know, we can't afford to have a financial audit each year. I'm saying, what? You as a broker, as an agent, you're responsible for the money for your clients, and you're not responsible for the money of your members. You have to have an audit. I mean, they would fight on that. So some associations need to consolidate and become large regionals like we are. I think that's great. Any association, I think, that has less than 500 members really struggles, and I don't know how they do it. That's concerned. As far as the MLS is concerned, I have a vision, maybe something similar to you, where maybe there should just be 6 or 7 large regional MLSs throughout the country, and then maybe one national database. That would be a great way to go. I don't know if that happened in my lifetime, but I think we should aim for that. That brings great efficiency. The reason why, you know, we haven't raised our dues since the year 2000, you haven't raised your fees, and and we still keep on increasing services because we're efficient and we capitalize on all these numbers that we have. So I'm all in favor of consolidation, but not if we have to lower our standards.
I didn't mean to take your hand again. Governance structures have always been an interesting debate as it relates to associations, even MLSs. Tenure in most associations around the country is a rite of passage. It seems like it is treated as such. And so unwieldy governance structures deals with both the quality of the leadership and the alacrity in which they make those decisions. Can you talk a little bit about your experience of the decision-making process that may even be, you know, your ideal? It may still be aspirational to you, so you can talk about your experience at NVAR, obviously, but also how could it be even better?
Now, I do a lot of teaching throughout the United States and even in Europe about decision-making process for board of directors. And I always say that, you know, when you bring a lot of people in, volunteers, and they've only got a couple of hours, they've got to make some key decisions, you as a staff person have to make that job as simple as possible. So I'll usually go in and say, all right, we have a decision to make. You have three choices. Option one, do nothing. Two is this. When you do that, you force people to concentrate on the end result. Now, they may go with option four, which is not even on there, but one that they come up with themselves. But I think it's our job as staff to give the elected leaders the opportunity to focus in on a decision that's 90% done, and then they have to custom tailor and then vote it up or down. I mean, our board's going to vote very soon, right, Mary, on the new CEO, you know? I think that the committee's done their homework, they brought in specialists, they've done all this work, they're going to go before the board of directors and say, okay, up or down. I think they're probably going to go up because they're going to say, these people put so much time and effort into it, as opposed to just willy-nilly putting an ad in the newspaper and say, well, let's just see who shows up. So this decision-making process, and you do this at MRIS as well, really well, you know, narrowing it down, and I might come back and say, okay, here's three options, and the board may say, well, we don't like any. I say, well, can you give me a couple of weeks? I'll come back with a few more. Or let's take one of these and start to combine them and make something happen. But the associations that fail are the ones where the staff person just pretty much says, we got a problem, it has to be solved, and sits back and lets the members, you know, fight among themselves. And as a result, they're all chasing their tail, and it's very sad to see that happen, and unfortunately it does.
If I could make one add-on comment before we move on beyond that, as it relates to the unwieldy governance structure. When directors or boards of directors are doing committee work, and this is no slant at committees because they're an important part, but when you ask the directors to also decide what should the color of the curtain be at the state convention or something like that, and I'm being facetious with that, I'm using that as probably a bad example, but you know, I think it goes to successful organizations versus those that are going to be unwieldy. And that's where you've got the resources and the staff, like you and Frank and Jill and the rest of the team here, that you have the staff that can make those decisions, and then you're right, come to the board with options. Those 2 hours, those 3 hours a month or every quarter, whatever you need, is real important. Give them the facts, give them up front, and then, you know, make the decisions as to what's going to happen. And, you know,
And then get out of the way.
Absolutely.
People around the country are amazed when I tell the story. When we built the new NVAR building, the board of directors pretty much said, okay, we found the land, here's the money. Chris, you and your staff, you know what you need in the building. We don't. You design it. So we met with architects. We went to the MRIS building. We went to the NAR building. I went to other associations. I sat down with my team and I said, okay, what do we need? What do we want? What's best for the members? We kind of envisioned that underground parking and coming in and having the atrium and having the classrooms and all of that. The board of directors never got involved in looking at any of that. I don't think Vin was when we cut the ribbon on that, I think that's the first time he saw the building. And when people walked in, they said, oh my gosh, it's fantastic. Now, as from a staff person, that's good news, bad news. The good news is it gave me the freedom to just work with the professionals and get it done. The bad news was, if I messed up, I was out of there real fast, right? But you have to have a trust between the leadership, but you say the resources and the staff. And that's why it went over so beautifully. We built that in 18 months, 4 years to get the approval, but in 18 months, once we had the green light, that building went up beautifully. And as you can see right now, the results speak for itself. And I think the members find it enjoyable, and it's, but that's part of the decision-making process, respecting both sides and having the resources and the staff talent to put together.
Okay, I've got another question for you, and it deals with another one of the challenges, dangers, and that's the marginal agents destroying the reputation of the realtor and or the industry. The real estate industry is saddled with a large number of part-time, untrained, unethical, or incompetent agents. This knowledge gap threatens the credibility of the industry. I'm going to make an editorial, and then I'm going to have you respond. First of all, 40% of the subscribers to MRIS don't have a transaction side. Think about that.
40%.
46,000 people subscribe to MRIS, and almost 40% don't have a transaction side. What are they doing? Are they the accidental salespeople? Are they just selling to their loved ones, their family? Are they? Is it a tax dodge? Is it social? Are they giving the information to their significant other to be a who might be in the mortgage business or something? I don't know. What is it? So I would tell you, my comment about this is, I don't worry about the unproductive ones as much as I worry about the unprofessional ones. So if we got 40% that don't have a transaction side, the one thing I will say, again, editorial, I think we should celebrate. My chairman, John Coyle, says, essentially, we should celebrate the fact that the barriers to entry are low, because you never know where that $10 million salesperson is going to come. It just can. He or she could be big in their neighborhood, their community, whatever. They could just glom onto this thing. How many times? We probably, some of us in this room have done that and came from another career entirely. The fact of the matter is, we allow them to stay. We train them, we put them in the classroom. You can't, agent can't learn anything in the classroom. It's got to be out in the field. Agents that are newly licensed should work with a team or work with another agent for a period of time, and then after that time, there should be some minimum number of transactions that they have in order for them to retain their license. That's my opinion. Can we get there? I think this kind of thing will still be a top of mind unless and until we do. So, having said all that, Christine, what do you think about the marginal agents destroying the reputation?
Well, there are marginal agents that are destroying the reputation, but there are also some very, very experienced ones that can also equally do a lot of damage. The ones that know how to manipulate the process, the ones that know how to take advantage of the rookies. It's amazing to me when you get some new people coming in and I see what's being done to them by others. So, you know, in any business, unfortunately, we have people who are not ethical or exploit other people. You know, that is quite awful. Been a lot of discussion about, you know, raising the bar at entry. Virginia does not have the highest entry level in the state and the country. As a matter of fact, we're probably in the bottom 20%. I think certainly we need more training for new people. You know, that's really important. I think NVAR spends a lot of time and money, a good part of its budget, on our legal hotline, our legal services, enforcing the code of ethics, risk reduction. We have three attorneys on staff. Right? That's unheard of for a local association, but you know what? You guys love it because you're using that hotline all the time. You're reading that because you value that, and it's my job to respond to that. So I think that basically people do want to do the right thing. But here's something interesting. Of the new people coming to the association right now, we're getting an average of 140 a month. Most of them will be gone in 3 years. It's like a revolving door. So I say to the new members, if you can make through the first 3 years, your chances of being successful after that are pretty good. But those first 3 years are critical. And you're right, they should team up. It should be through an apprentice period. But to throw somebody out there without any help, it's very difficult for them to say. So it is difficult for us to have all our services just around the new agent. I have to also remember, the majority of you are advanced top producing agents, and we have to have programs like this that appeal more to you than to a person who's been in the business 6 months.
NER's complex governance structure encumbers its ability to adopt strategies, tactics, and policies that are appropriate for the future. An example, there's 830 directors on the NER board of directors. I think there's 800 plus anyway. Talk about an unwieldy governance structure. I don't know whether or not most of those directors know what they're even voting on. I don't know that they don't, but I'm assuming that they don't know. All right, that's the NVAR directors, but there's 820 somewhere else in the they aren't, and may not be. So I believe that's an issue. And then I also believe, quite frankly, here we are, we're deciding who the president of NAR is going to be in 2020 or 21 right now. Can any of us imagine what our business is going to look like in 6 years? I mean, is that really the right way for us to do it? Again, it goes to, is tenure a rite of passage? So do we want to comment on the governance structure there? And do you think it encumbers or does it support policies that are appropriate for the future?
I think it works just fine. And I'll tell you why. Because the board of directors in NAR, you're right, over 850, and I've served on it several times that I know, really is taking its cue in the decision-making process from the executive committee. The executive committee is about 32 people. All right, that is a huge, so I see the executive committee as really the ones that have a tremendous amount of knowledge. They meet for days on end, they study the issues, they decide amongst themselves, okay, here's a big policy change we have to make. They will recommend to the board of directors, okay, we're the executive committee, we recommend to 850 of you that you vote this up or you vote this down. And 98% of the time, they will follow the lead of the executive committee. That's a well-informed body. So the board of directors of NAR, I think, is in some ways, I don't want to say a rubber stamp, but they sort of validate what this group of 32 very highly specialized people do. So I'm not so concerned about that. I think what NAR has done over the years in working with a lot with task force, with forums, and bringing in a lot of specialty groups and getting away from the committees and more into specialty groups, they are allowed to work a lot faster. So I am not as concerned about that. I think that is overstated, and I have no concern about that whatsoever, having served on the directors for many years. And you have too, right? I have.
So we agree to disagree. So the next topic, and that is dangers impacting the brokers. Do you want to chat a little bit about that? And the one challenge that is suggested here is the regulatory creep in the large financial penalties increase the compliance costs. Well, the CFPB now is pushed back to October 1, I believe.
October 3rd.
October 3rd. Is that because it's a Friday or I can't remember? Yeah. The first was on a Saturday or something.
Probably getting rolled again.
Yeah, it might get rolled again.
Thanks to NAR.
Absolutely. And that is absolutely one of the shining stars of NAR, is that they have a Have My Back advocacy program. I can't tell you whether it's on patent trolls, whether it's on copyrights, whether it's on legislative reforms, whether it's on MID. There's nobody better suited in this industry than the National Association to impact policy on a national level. They are the bomb. They're the best at that, and I have to give them kudos. So, what do you think about this tsunami that's going to hit? Do you think it's going to come and go, and that we're going to adapt, or do you think it's going to stick around for a while, Christina?
As Shakespeare said, I think it's much ado about nothing.
I think it's going to change. I think it's going to change the first month or two that it's implemented. I think it's going to delay a number of things, and we're going to adapt. That's what I believe. Now, the challenge with this organization, from my perspective, is that there's no boundaries as to what it can and can't do. So that's going to be the interesting thing, and that's where I think NAR is going to be able to amp. The local associations, clearly, and voices like NVAR are really going to help us. Really going to help us. So, anyway, you want to take this back? You want to take questions? What do you want to do?
Yeah, let's take some questions.
All right, we'll take some questions. Tom!
Yeah. Well, with regard to the last issue, I kind of disagree with you, Christine, because the CFPB, they're kind of making it up as they go along.
Right.
There's really no structure to what they're doing, and they're just really getting started on us. And I see what they've done. All you have to do is do a Google search for CFPB space fines. And there's pages and pages of a lot of fines in the mortgage industry, title, but they're now zeroing in on us. And so as a broker owner, there are many people, I know some of the people that I talk to are saying, why am I doing this again? Because I can be fined like out of business, and they're making the rules up. In many cases, if you look at what they've done with the mortgage industry, there are no real rules. They just decide that's what they're going to do, and then they do it, and then there's a fine, and then you got to go fight them in court or go out of business.
But who caused the problem?
I don't know. I didn't.
Who caused the problem? You know, the lenders are walking around in Virginia giving loans, unlicensed loan officers, unlicensed, walking around in this commonwealth, giving $750,000 loans to people who work in Target for $18,000 a year, and brought us to our knees. Now we're being overregulated. It's true, the pendulum has swung the other way. Right. So you know what? It will come back. And I think we will adjust. So I am not overly concerned about it. I'm not going to obsess and go do all the Googling like you're doing, because you'll make yourself crazy. I think let's just wait and see what happens. I think that people are getting educated. And the ones that are causing problems, and there are people out there that are still trying to, you know, always skirt the rules and regulations and harm people. I mean, what damage was done to people's livelihood when they were thrown out of their homes, when they lost their credit? I mean, people were really hurt by what went on with that credit debacle. So now it's overregulated. It'll come back. I think, and the National Association of Realtors, I think this is issue number one for them, believe me. They're the ones that got the extension until October. If they get it again, fine. If not, they've got a mad dash going on right now in every association to get the information out. And I love the new cover of Time Magazine. Who's afraid of Elizabeth Warren? I didn't know anybody saw that, but I'm going to send it to you. But you know, she's the one that's had a lot of power and influence on it and through this. I think she's a person who eventually will see we have to come back more to center. But you should read that issue of Time Magazine.
I'm just wondering if the NAR has given any thought to looking at what the CFPB is doing with their myopic view, only seeing one entity of a real estate transaction as the general public, and ignoring the fact that there is another member of the public seller involved in the transaction, and that they completely don't exist in their view of making their policies. But at some point, that person probably would be a general seller.
I think the National Association of Realtors, at their peril, if they only looked at any changes to the regulations without looking at it from the point of view of the consumer as well. So they do have a lot of consumer input. They've got a lot of consultants on this. I think it would be very, unfair if you just go in and say, we just want to look at the real estate piece and the heck with everybody else. So I truly believe that they're looking at the whole picture. But time will tell. You know, we're so fortunate. Maybe another forum is to bring in some of the lobbyists that live and work right here in Northern Virginia, ones especially that are working on this, and say, you know, let's answer that question. Tell us what you are doing. We are blessed to have them living right here in our region, the lobbyists for the National Association of Realtors.
Tracy? Oh, I was just going to say that I frankly don't think there's anything wrong with this new regulation. Of course, there will be hiccups. We know that. But I think if we get, all of us get educated prior to October the 3rd, we will have no problems. But we have to get the title companies and the mortgage lenders in sync with the process. And we realtors will then, but we have to stay on top of things which we didn't have to stay on top of before. And the terminology, you know, people coming into the business 10 years from now will have no clue the word settlement ever existed. They'll always think it's a consummation or, you know, with the terminology. So I think that we as realtors have to embrace it and go forward with it, because our main thing in our profession is to protect our clients, our profession. So I think this will help in that direction.
Yeah, I think the regulations, I mean, the objective is to help everybody. It's not to put people out of business or to cause a lot of disruption in the business. So if that happens, that has to be changed. But the intent, I think, is a good one. By the way, you can all get a copy of this danger report. Now, you see, I got the hard copy here. Because when I went online and it said, you know, do you want to download it or do you want it? I asked for this. So I think if you're like me, you don't want to read the whole thing, you know, print out 165 pages. If they have any left, you might want to request a hard copy yourself and do your own assessment as a broker, as an agent, and see what the dangers are and how frightened you are about some of them. We want to mention that you can read more about the report in our a magazine,
And we also want to, you know, remind you to also look for the Swanepoel Trend Report. Again, Stefan Swanepoel will be speaking. He will be the opening speaker at our convention. By the way, the closing speaker, this is interesting, the closing speaker at the convention is Jonathan Smoke, who is the chief economist for Realtor.com. And he also happens to live in Alexandria, so that's going to, so he always follows the economy, but especially in our region, because he lives here, right? So what a great convention we're going to have. We think we're going to be talking about the trends that Stefan Swanepoel has identified. You'll have a chance to ask him more questions about the report and challenge him on some points. And then to have the convention end with the chief economist from Realtor.com, who has some, I just came from a meeting, by the way, David, you were there too, right, in South Carolina?
Yeah, right.
And he talked about, I said, what's going on with, you know, Realtor.com and Zillow? And he shared to us that right now, from what they can see, traffic on Zillow has peaked. And traffic on Realtor.com is still starting to creep up. Will the two of them finally clash, and will there be a winner? I don't know. It'll be interesting to hear what he has to say about that.
I absolutely believe the portals that this is the clash of the titans, between News Corp and Zillow, or the Zillow Group. And I'm not surprised that when we were at a meeting, but we were a day apart. They had a meeting for MLS executives and association executives. It wasn't that big a meeting, so we just came a day apart. So I didn't know that you were following it. But the important thing to keep in mind about the portals is that real estate never owned search. It never did. This feels like the newspapers back in the 90s. You know, remember when we'd get all upset when the newspapers would, you'd have all your classifieds in there, and then they'd put a do-it-yourself ad in there, or an article or an editorial in there, and it just got everybody all amped up. But the important thing to remember is real estate never owned search. Again, if this room or this industry's vision is that real estate should revolve around search, I think it's a mistake. It's in the collaboration with the consumer. It's in the exchange of ideas and information. How they get to you is, it's not immaterial and it's not inexpensive, but you can always vote with your feet. You can always vote with your feet. And we've developed a relationship more recently with Zillow, simply out of necessity. The pipeline that went between a Move subsidiary, ListHub, and Zillow broke down in April. And so our board of directors, in their infinite wisdom, said, well, what are we going to do about this for the people that want it? So we repaired the pipeline. That's all we did. And people chose to opt in or chose to opt out. And that's all we've done. We have no greater relationship with them than that. It seems to be working just fine. I haven't heard a hue and cry about this. There's some, quite frankly, there's some brokers who have direct feeds with Zillow that their information is not as updated as, say, ours is, or there's challenges with it. But that's okay. The broker can decide to do that. So I think the portal wars are going to be great. It's grand theater. Quite frankly, I'm a little upset that I'm not a millionaire today, and that I have so many friends that work at Zillow and Move and Trulia that are now millionaires. Why didn't they call me? I don't know. I didn't get it. Did any of you? I don't think so. So this is going to be real interesting, this whole thing. Now you've got the broker public portal. It's a topic of conversation where the brokers are trying again to reclaim the high ground, and they're talking about creating a national portal where all the listings could reside, sans any distracting stuff like leads and competing agents and all this other stuff. It's an interesting notion. I'm watching it carefully. We have invested a very modest amount of money, $5,000, to have a seat at the table so we can understand what's going on. But I don't know how that portal is going to compete with Realtor and Zillow and Homes and Washington Post and these other, the New York Times. I don't know how they're going to do that. But why not try it, right? Why not try it? Yes, John.
So on the subject of upstream, as I understand it, what created this was RPR's ability to take different information from different platforms and put it together and send it out. Do you think it's a possibility that the ability to do this is going to give them the opportunity to bring in contracts, bring in home inspections, bring in all these other parts of the transaction so that we have a platform for settlement attorneys and lenders and everyone else involved? It just seems like that would be the migration for it.
I'm gonna side with Christine, which we do a lot, but not always. I think it's a national database of information, and then there's localization that's all around. It's up to MRIS or some company like us to put that seamless experience together for the local markets. I don't see NAR doing this. NAR, actually, it's a bit of a misnomer that they collect all that information. All that information goes into a company called Real Estate Digital, which also owns a company called Zone, which happens to be an interesting new brokerage model that's come out. And RED, or Real Estate Digital, is the company that feeds all the information to RPR. So RPR doesn't assemble the information, they distribute the information in a unified experience, in a unified search experience. And so I don't see that happening. I don't see NAR doing it. But that's where we should have our vision.
Yeah, it would seem to me that it would just benefit the consumer, you know, because think about it, 5 years down the road, the consumer wants to have access to that last home inspection report. It could be right there with the rest of the information. And that would be attractive for realtors. It would give us more services to provide they couldn't get if they went out on the local market by themselves.
More questions? More comments? Yes, sir. Ty.
How many questions am I allowed?
As long as they're all directed to her, I don't care.
Well, I got pretty short questions, address different areas, and you feel free to take off your hat of a CEO of NVAR, take off the hat of a CEO of MRIS, because it could be general and it could be very specific to your...
You need a microphone?
Can I speak louder?
Sure. That would help.
Okay. First question is, obviously there will be less agents in the industry because of all the evolution. Thank you. So my first question is, I expect to have less agents in the association as well as in the industry. How does that affect the association, number one? How does that affect the MLS, number two? How does it affect the industry as a whole? That's number three. That's question one. Question two would be, what is the future is like for a small broker? There are a whole lot of evolution trend going on. Obviously, a lot of merger, a lot of acquisition, a lot of unsupported brokers getting out of business, basically. That would be the trend. And how does it affect, number one, the broker themselves? Are they going to be an extinct, or how they affect the association and the MLS as well? Last question, but not least, would be, have you ever considered, and I'm sure that you have, so you don't have to answer that yes, no question, but one of the biggest questions of all time would be, when or whether or not the MLS will be able to generate leads for the agents? And how is it going to happen, whether or not it's going to be coming soon? Because that could be a competitive advantage of the MLS versus other portals.
You want to? You know, I'm wearing my Donald Trump tie today.
That's why.
He's a work he is.
The fires.
So the whole issue of fewer agents, I don't know that that's necessarily so. We think that's going to happen, but I think there's going to continue. Look, even when MRIS had 60,000 agents in our subscriber base, it was still around 35% or so that didn't have a transaction site. When it was just, the industry was rocking. You know, so I think there's always going to be those non-producers, and it's unless and until that we as associations and MLSs and brokers stop catering to the least common denominator, and that we do insist on internship or alignment with teams or an agent for some period of time with some minimum number of transactions thereafter, then I think unless and until that happens, it won't occur. Now, what could happen is that people could be like in Southern Virginia and just decide that they don't want to be a part of the association because they don't find value. I can't imagine being in Northern Virginia quite frankly, any of the MRIS shareholder associations without seeing real value. But again, this is something that, you know, our shareholder associations, I think, have done all along. So to Chris's earlier point, if they're financially strapped, those guys leave the business, you know, and can't get in, then those associations, that could probably be one of the greatest things that happened to consolidation. The small broker. I believe the small broker is in an absolutely wonderful position. If you, how many people read Inman Select? Yeah, so that's part of your MRIS subscription. If you're not, get it. You're paying for it. Please use it. It's really pretty interesting. But Ty, they have lots of great articles on that about the indie brokers and what those indie brokers are doing, and those guys that have 4, 5, 8, 10 agents, things like that. They're doing wonderful things because they can be so mobile. So I think the small broker is just going to kick it going forward. I think they're absolutely going to be great. As far as distributing leads on the part of the MLS, you're absolutely right, provided we can find a model. It generally means you've got to have a pretty robust consumer-facing portal in order to generate those leads. And MRIS has always been designed to be an entry portal, not a destination site. All we want to do is turn the agent over to the broker, or the consumer over to the agent and the broker as quickly as possible. We don't give them all the information. We don't have all the bells and whistles. Our Mosaic initiative that's just come out in the last couple weeks, I think, is going to help with that and create a collaboration environment for them. It's still in beta. We ought to have it rolled out officially in the next week or two. We've gone ahead a couple bumps in the road. But I think, provided the MLS builds a robust consumer-facing website, yes, we can take care of those leads and push them out. I think it's a wonderful place for us to be. But right now, we're an entry portal. If we get permission to go beyond that, then we would probably need to really consider that.
Yeah, Ty, I'm not really sure we're going to see less agents. You know, we still have over 1.1 million. You know, I was on the NAR Finance Committee years ago, and we had when the market really went down bad. And I thought, oh my God, you know, the NAR started to readjust its budget. We're going to lose, you know, they lost maybe 200,000, but they came right back. So I'm amazed because, again, like I say, it's an easy in, easy out profession. The entry level is way too low. That has to change. You're on the VAR Board of Directors. You've got to work hard at the Virginia Association of Realtors to get the word out. They have got to raise that entry level. I mean, it takes more hours to become a manicurist in Virginia than it does to become a realtor. Something is not right. That has to change. So as long as you've got that easy entry, and it's not really that expensive. I mean, people complain about the dues and the MRIS fees, but where else can you start a business with $1 billion worth of inventory for $1,000? I mean, that's unheard of. So I don't see less agents coming in. If anything, I just see the turnstile maybe going a little bit faster. I agree with David, the future of the small broker is fine with old technology. I look at Mary, she can do everything she needs to right out of her house and her office, everything, right? The people who I think are threatened are the little guy, the ones in the middle. You know, they've got the overhead, but they don't have the economy of scale like a big company does. I would be concerned about them. And there's also a lot of discussion about teams. Are teams becoming so strong and so powerful and so well-branded that they are actually surpassing their broker? And the broker's taking on all the risk, right? Providing all the infrastructure, and the teams are putting all their money in their pocket. I'm amazed by that. I don't know how a lot of that's going to If I was to become an agent, I'd go into a big team. And then the MLS getting the leads, I don't know about that, but I was intrigued by a statement made by the president of Zillow, Spencer Radcroft. You and I were at the Inman conference T3 conference, somewhere with Marriott is there as well. And this president of Zillow was getting up there and he was talking about this company, and somebody was making a complaint or a statement that a lot of the information on Zillow was not correct.
Yeah.
And he said, remember, we're in the advertising business. So whether the ad is correct or not, what's he care? He's already got his money, right? If you were putting an ad for a home in the Washington Post and the price was wrong or it was already sold, the Washington Post doesn't care. It cut its money for the ad. That's how you have to look at Zillow to a certain extent. Now, they are, I think, making a concerted effort to try to clean up that database because they do know that it's not 100%. As opposed to the MLS's, which yours I think is probably 99% accurate. So, you know, some people are enamored by these portals, but understand what they are. They're just an advertising vehicle getting your money
maybe you'll get a lead, maybe you won't, maybe the information's accurate, they don't really care, they're just trying to look for a way to increase their bottom line. At least with realtors.com, what I like about them, their bottom line is important to them, now that they're owned by News Corp, but they also continue to emphasize you must keep the realtor as part of the transaction. And just watch the advertisement. If you look at an ad for Zillow, there's never a broker or an agent in it. If you look at the ones for realtor.com, the ones that you pay for, you'll always see the agent there escorting the buyer or the serving the seller with, you know, with the property. So be careful that you understand, you know, where you're spending your money and who's, how they're profiteering off of you. Anita?
I totally agree with you. However, the public is looking at Zillow, and really, I mean, blasting the agents who have listings because it's not accurate, because if the agents put it in at a certain hour, it may not get uploaded or uploaded correctly. Their name or their picture is not on it unless they pay for premium access. Whereas, so that's where the public is looking now, and this is where we're having a lot of problems with our sellers, because they don't understand. The information, like you say, is inaccurate. So is there nothing there that we can do or someone can do?
I think you have to really be strong as a manager, and I know you are, Anita, to say to your agents, to explain to the sellers that, you know, yeah, I can put your property on Zillow, but understand it's not, you know, you have to educate the public. If somebody came to me and explained to me that you've already put it on a site where I know it's not going to be accurate, it's going to cause a lot of unnecessary phone calls and problems, as a seller, I'd say, well, okay, you're the expert, I'll rely on you. Now, you're not going to get 100% of people to go with that, but I think that part, sometimes the agent gives in too easily when the seller says, I want it on Zillow. But if you explain to them why you don't, and you give them a rational, they say, okay, well, and, you know, let my company, let us try selling it on our own. You don't need to have these companies that and are not interested in the accuracy of your property as we are. That's a hard sell, but that's what I would do.
I think it's a great statement that you make. Perception invariably lags reality, right? So in April, we started a direct feed with the Zillow Group, and our mark should be on all the listings to say that was where the information was sourced. They pull about every 15 minutes the information. So it's 15 minutes behind in the MRIS system, but it's close enough. It's close enough. So those perceptions should change over time. So you ask, how can we do something about it? I think we as a business, MRIS, we made a mistake a couple of years ago, maybe 8 years ago, when we ceded responsibility for the distribution of the information to a third party whose business model went through an enormous change. The company is called ListHub. And so they would set this up on 12 or 24 hour increments and things like that. You know, how many times do you get something in your inbox that says, hey, we've got a new publisher, it's called elookyloo.com or something like that, where all this information gets out. So what we are attempting to do, and I think it's an excellent question, is we are going to contract directly with at least the larger entities, and they are going to have a licensing agreement with us, MRIS, that will ensure that the information at your direction, not mine, at yours, is there, it's current, or it's not. And if it's not current, then clearly there's a technical problem. But the challenge we had as a business was, do we feed this beast called the portal? But again, we really came down on the side that this is about search. This is about accuracy is very important, but you know, nobody had a corner on accuracy like realtor.com. And they even had a marketing campaign called Accuracy Matters. Nobody cared, you know? Nobody cared. It's just they want, and the consumer may want to get in the debate with you. You know, they may want to challenge you. Yeah, but that's what it is. But you've learned how to argue those challenges. It's not like flies at a picnic. You're still going on the picnic, you know? Maybe not. Or just don't go on as many.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Chris and David. Let's give them a warm applause. Thank you for coming out. Thank you. time ever, your busy time, and sharing your insight and perspective in this really hot topic. With that, I do want to mention what's coming up again. Chris mentioned the NVAR convention and trade show in October. It's Tuesday, October 13th over at NOVA in Annandale. And again, it's awesome that we're getting Stefan Swanpole to be our keynote speaker. Once you get to dig into the report, you're going to see why it's so important to show up that day. Also, Jonathan Smoke will be there as well. So, and again, you'll see a lot of your vendor partners and what have you. The other speakers that usually the NVAR staff books, they're usually national speakers as well. So make sure, make the effort to come out and bring your bag of grocery. Also, we have lunch in the back, so hopefully you can stay and network and enjoy a Vietnamese lunch. It's a light summer menu, so make sure to stay tuned for that. And then lastly, just to wrap it all up, you know, some of the key things, it's pretty scary what they brought up. And again, there's a hundred, they only covered like a small portion of what was in the report. But the key message is we really need to stop, do that mirror test. Sometimes we don't want to know what's really there. But for us to succeed in the future, our industry is very dynamic, and it's important for us to do that mirror test, acknowledge it, come up with a plan, and, you know, be nimble to the change that needs to be made. Okay, so with that, thanks again for joining the Vietnamese Forum. Thank you, VHTA, for sponsoring it. Thank you, Linda. You're always coming out and supporting us every year. So with that, have a great lunch, and thanks for coming.